Brother Gary Wiseman, while you're standing, take us to the Lord in prayer this morning.
Father God, Lord, we just thank you for another morning in your house, Lord. We thank you for all those that made choices to be here, Lord. We just pray for those that's not here, Lord, for whatever reason. Lord, I ask your blessing upon them, Lord. Pray you bring to Charlie this morning as he leads the service, Lord, and be with our Sunday school teacher as he brings forth your word, Lord, and let us be attentive to listen to your word into our hearts.
Amen. Take your hymnals and open it up to 434. I know who holds tomorrow. How many of us know that?
You know, we live in a world of uncertain things, uncertain times going on around us today, but I'm glad, brother, there's another day coming.
Amen.
Beautiful sunshine out there. Hey, that just makes you feel better just to see the sunshine in the bright. A two-letter word has 100 completely different meanings. So what is this stuff about English being easy? There is a two-letter word that perhaps has more meaning than any other two-letter word, and that is up. It's easy to understand up, meaning toward the sky or at the top of the list. But when we waken in the morning, why do we wake up? At a meeting, why does a topic come up? Why do we speak up? And why are the officers up for election? And why is it up to the secretary to write up a report? We call up our friends, and we use it to brighten up a room, polish up the silver. We warm up the leftovers and clean up the kitchen. We lock up the house, and some guy fixes up old cars. Other times, the little word has really real spatial meanings. People stir up, line up for tickets. work up an appetite and think up excuses. To be dressed is one thing, but to be dressed up is special. And this is confusing. A drain must be opened up because it is stopped up. We open up a stove, we open up a store in the morning, but we close it up at night. We seem to be pretty mixed up about up. To be knowledgeable of the proper use of up, look up the word in the dictionary. In a desk-sized dictionary, the word up takes up almost one-fourth of the page, and definitions add up to about 30. If you are up to it, you might try building up a list of many ways up is used. It will take up a lot of your time, but if you don't give up, you may wind up with 100 or more. When it threatens to rain, we say it is clouding up. When the sun comes out, we say it is getting up. When it rains, it wets up the earth. When it doesn't rain for a while, things dry up. One could go on and on, but I'll wrap it up now, and my time is up, so I'll just shut up. You know, there are two-letter words that, you know, you can use them in about everything. But anyway, it's good to be here this morning. In the way of birthdays, we have Delbert Beckner listed for January the 9th, which is tomorrow. Leanne Willis, that's John's mother, has got one the 14th. We don't have any anniversaries listed, but is there any birthdays or anniversaries?
We have one from last Sunday who's sitting on the other end of this pew right here.
Yeah.
Brother Norman's birthday was last Sunday.
Yeah, it was.
Happy birthday to him.
Yeah.
Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday, God bless you. Happy birthday to you. And many, many more. In Isaiah 43, verse 25 says, I, even I, am he who blots out your transgressions. That's Jesus speaking. When Charles Wesley explained the joy of divine forgiveness, he told a friend on his new sense of pardon and added, I suppose I better keep silent about it. Oh, no, my brother, came the reply. If you had 1,000 tongues, you should go and use them all for Jesus. Charles Wesley went home and wrote the great hymn, Oh, for 1,000 tongues to sing my great Redeemer's praise, the glory of my God and King, the triumph of his grace. To a burden belighted world, crushed under the weight of his own wickedness, God says, I, even I, am he who blots out your transgression. This is glorious news, and it applies to all people everywhere, including you. Have you received God's gift of forgiveness? If you have, thank him for it. And if not, by faith, invite him into your life today. We pray that all here is saved. I thought a verse of scripture has hit my mind this morning or this week, and I can't let it go for some reason. It's Romans chapter 7, verse 7, if you want to read it with me. Just one verse there. Chapter 7 of Romans, verse 7. What shall we say then? Is the law sin? God forbid. Nay, I had not known sin, but by the law. This is the part I want you to think on. For I had not known lust, except the law had said, thou shalt not covet. When you think about the laws, that lust is usually the first thing that enters the mind when you commit adultery, when you steal. It starts here, you lust after it. And then after the lust becomes the desire of the heart, and you If you let that happen, it'll be sin. Anyway, let's all stand. Let's do the pledges this morning for the Bible first. I pledge allegiance to the Bible, God's holy word. I will make a light to my feet and a light to my path. I will hide its words in my heart that I might not sin against God. To the Christian flag, I pledge allegiance to the Christian flag and to the Savior, which stands and stands, one Savior, crucified, risen, and coming again with life and liberty to all who believe. To the American flag, I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the Republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all. Amen. Is there anything else I need to say besides the Lord's Prayer? Anybody got any announcements you want to make now?
We have singers will be here tonight.
Singers will be here tonight. What's their names? I read it in the bulletin, but
God's messengers.
Yeah, God's messengers. So let's make an effort to come out tonight and bring somebody with you to hear God's word and also some music. Let's pray. Our Father, which art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, in earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever. Amen. Teachers may take their classes.
The song says, open up your heart and let the sun shine in, but whatever you do, don't open your doors. it's cold outside. Amen. Amen. Brother Gary Eberts, would you want to bless the offering for us this morning, please?
Father, we come this morning and thank you, Father, first of all, for keeping us safe tonight and giving us another day. We thank you for the sun shining. We pray that our hearts warm up to the weather, Lord, no matter what. This is the time for it. We just pray and just be with us. Keep us all safe, Lord. Get the offering, Lord, to be lifted, Lord. Be with our teachers, Lord, to bring the word. That's our heart, Lord. Help us to be open and faithful to you, Lord. It's in Jesus' precious name.
Amen. Amen. But it is, even though it's cold, it is a beautiful day. The day that the Lord hath made, we will rejoice and be glad therein, right? Amen. Our lesson this morning is in Luke chapter 6. Luke chapter 6. Master, or the key verse, or the title is Jesus the Master Teacher. Key verse is, a good man out of good treasure of his heart bringeth forth that which is good. But an evil man out of that evil treasure of his heart bringeth forth that which is evil, for the abundance of the heart the mouth will speak. If your heart's wicked, you'll speak wicked things. If your heart's good and pure, you'll speak good and pure things, right? Someone that's always condescending with their words, but they've got problems that lies far beyond what you see there in the flesh. Inside, amen, they've got that evil heart. Lesson objectives, I love these objectives. I thought, man, they just reading these objectives this morning ought to make us shout. To see how living for Jesus affects living with others, amen. And if we don't see that, then Christ is not inside of us today. To love Jesus so much, we follow his example. Now wrap your head around that. To love Jesus so much that we follow his example. He said, if you love me, keep my commandments. Right? And I don't think he's speaking of the ten. Jesus gave a commandment. He said, this commandment that I give unto you, a new commandment that I give unto you, that you love one another as I have loved you. How did he love them? In so much that he laid down his life for them, right? Not only for them, but thank God for us. To make sure we are building on the sand. Nope. Building on the rock. What rock? Christ. On Christ's solid rock I stand. All other ground is sinking sand. The writer, I believe in Hebrews, said they followed that rock, they drank of that rock, and that rock was Christ. Amen. Our quarterly start with verse 20 this morning, but I'm actually going to read some verses before that to you. That way you know where we're coming from. If you just jump into this, you think, well, this sounds like the Sermon on the Mount, but it's not. Listen, and he came down with them and stood in the plain, and the company of disciples, and this is verse 17, and a great multitude of people went out of all Judea and Jerusalem and from the sea coast of Tyre and Sidon, which came to hear him, and he healed to be healed of their diseases. And they that were vexed with unclean spirits, and they were healed. And the whole multitude sought to touch him, for there went out virtue out of him and healed some? Nope. Them all. Everyone that sought and reached out and got close enough to touch him was healed. I wonder sometimes the things that we often long for in life today that we don't get is because we live too far away from where the Master is. Could be. I realize that again, we're all like Paul. We're going to have a thorn in the flesh, right? To keep us walking, I guess, the straight and narrow. But these people saw him, and by faith, they touched him. What made them whole was their faith. How do you know that? Go to the woman that had the issue of blood, that tried everything. And when she touched Jesus, you know, Jesus said, who touched me? He knew it was. Who touched me? And she came forth trembling, fell at his feet, and said, Master, it was me. And he said, daughter, be of good cheer. Thy faith hath made me. I mean, she was scared. I believe she was trembling. But she knew what had happened inside of her. I believe the inside, she was rejoicing. She knew she was made whole because she felt the virtue. But all of a sudden, he's calling, you know, who is it? Can you see her? And as she comes trembling, according to the scriptures, fell at his feet. You know, we're not worthy.
No, not one.
No, not one. We're not worthy to pray and call on the name of Jesus. We're not worthy to call out to God the Father in the name of Jesus except that the blood of Christ has been applied to us. Amen?
Praise the Lord.
All right. That gives us the background on where we're at. And, you know, I'm telling you, all these people thronging him and touching him and all the power of God that's going out of his body, we have to remember this. Although he was God, although he was anointed, filled with the Holy Ghost, and that virtue flowed through him, yet he was a physical man. And I'm telling you, when the power of God, and you can witness to this yourself, when the power of God has been on your body strong and you've been rejoicing and praising God, when that calms down, buddy, you're weak, you're tired. I mean, the harder I preach, the more God anoints me to preach, I'm telling you, the weaker I feel when it's time to sit down. Especially like last week, I go out and I preach three times. Brother, I'm busted. I can't, you know, it used to be I could probably preach four or five times. I'm busted. They tell me that Oliver B. Green used to preach 7 to 10 times a day. You know what happened to Oliver B. Green? He died of a heart attack. He literally wore himself out preaching the gospel. He pushed himself to preach that much, but
even us, when we're in spirit, and I believe that I have felt that way into several services, and by the end of the day, I am saved. Not because I physically did anything, spiritually.
It will physically drain you. That's right. Not and mentally. I mean, you want to run a marathon. I mean, we come here and we have a powerhouse meeting. You know, Sunday morning we have a good time. Sunday night we've had a good time. Maybe we've been out and did a college prayer meeting, did something down through the day. And, oh my Lord, you're charged up. You're ready to go. Maybe somebody's gotten saved and everybody around the house is rejoicing. And, you just want to go, go, go. But as quick as your bottom hits the chair, whether it be the easy chair or the... In my case, the vehicle going home. There have been a couple of times my wife has had to drive home. I've been so tired. And I don't say that braggingly. I just bragging on what God does, all right? Amen. He's good to us, I'm telling you this morning. All right. If someone would read verse 20, 21, and 22, please.
And he lifted up his eyes on his disciples and said, "Blessed be ye poor, for yours is the kingdom of God. Blessed are ye that hunger now, for ye shall be filled. Blessed are ye that weep now, for ye shall laugh. Blessed are ye when men shall hate you, and when they shall separate you from their company, and shall reproach you, and cast out your name as evil, for the Son of Man's sake."
Now he's tired. Again, all this has went out. Now I realize there's no verse here that talks about that Jesus is tired. But I'm telling you, he's tired. Physically, he looks up and he sees these people and he has compassion upon them. And when he lifted up his eyes and on his disciples, he said, listen who he's speaking to here. To his disciples, "Blessed be ye poor, for yours is the kingdom of God." Now, when he's talking about disciples here, are you thinking of the 12? Because if you are, you're thinking inside the box. His disciples today include you and I. A disciple is an individual that follows. Where's that coming from, Judy? And we'll try to get it blocked out. Brother Larry, can you close that blind right there? I mean, it's going over there and hitting them people right in the face. It's beautiful, but it's kind of hard to see. It'll irritate your eyes. There we go. There we go. Yeah. Where were you when the lights went out? "Blessed be ye poor, for yours is the kingdom of God." Now, if y'all rich people in here, y'all can't rejoice on that. I think we're all okay on this one, don't you? We can rejoice. The kingdom of God. Now, what is the kingdom of God? If you're going to rejoice over something, rejoice. Blessed are the kingdom of God. It's yours. What is the kingdom of God then? "I'm so glad I'm a part of the family of God. I've been washed in the fountain, cleansed by his blood, joined heirs with Jesus, and together with this God. And I'm so glad I'm a part of the family." That's what the kingdom of God is. You see, a kingdom is made up of people and relationships. My, we are blessed. Is it not a blessing? I mean, you guys are a blessing to me. And don't you feel that way about everybody else? Not only the folks that attend this church, but the other brothers and sisters that we fellowship with, other churches that, you know, we come in contact with. In the times past, have some men that have, absolutely. But I'm still glad that I'm part of the family of God. Because, amen, you fight with your brothers and sisters when you were growing up living in the same house, amen. But you fought with one another, but I tell you what, you sure would fight for one another too. And that's the way it ought to be here in this house, right? So we are blessed because the kingdom of God is where, by the way? The kingdom of God is within us. Amen, that church. Blessed are ye that hunger now. Why blessed are they that hunger now? Hunger after what?
The Word of God.
The Word of God or righteousness. You got to realize, again, when Jesus came, the religious system was so corrupt that, I mean, they did everything but seek God. And the people that begin to seek God, and that, you know, all through the Scriptures in the Old Testament, when people sought God, you know what happened? He was found of them. I mean, there was not one person that truly sought God that God said, you know, I don't have time for you. And I worry about ministers that tell people, you know, that they don't have time for people that are hurting and all these different things. Blessed are ye that hunger now, for ye shall be filled. The thing that you have, I'm going to tell you something. You've got as much as God inside of you as what you want. Your relationship with God is exactly what you want. This time last year, I was preaching on champs and chumps. I started the first Sunday of last year preaching that sermon series. Champs are chumps. And again, the effort is what determines what we are today. And that's in everything in our life today. If we don't put forth the effort, it don't happen. Right? So, blessed are ye that hunger. When you're hungry, do you sit and starve? Now think about this. What do you do? Woman, get in the kitchen and fix me a sandwich. Huh? No. He says, baby, die, would you fix me a sandwich? Pretty please with sugar on top. You know I love you. Well, what kind do you want? It don't matter. Well, what kind do you want? You've been there, ain't you, Charlie? Well, I don't want peanut and butter and jelly. It shoots my sugar up. Well, you want ham or bologna? Either one. Which one you want? At least she's laughing at me. For ye shall be filled. Blessed are ye that weep now. For ye shall laugh. For ye shall laugh, not laugh. For ye shall laugh. Sound like Emma Fudd. What does it mean to weep, by the way? Weeping, by the way, is not crying.
Sorrowful.
Weeping involves, and I saw Linda Dimmel, she put it on, and Cheryl probably read it as well. She put it on there yesterday, or Friday, well, maybe it's Friday, about weeping. He said it's how different it was from crying. It involves a total, from your head to your feet. And you're just weak when you weep. I mean, we come in here, you know, we cry because we get blessed. I do. I mean, I get happy and shout and run, whatever, but when I cry, you know, but to weep. Blessed are you that weep. Why do people weep, by the way? Let's look at that. We may not get through all these today. I ain't got a watch, so somebody have to bear with me. I forgot to put it on this morning. Why do we weep? Give me some reasons why we... Why did Jesus weep? There you find two places in the Scripture that Jesus wept. One was because Lazarus, you know, where have you laid him? When they said, Lord, come and see, and Jesus wept. His heart was hurting, sorrowful for them. And then on the mountain, when he looked down over Jerusalem, Jesus began to weep, and he said, "Oh, Jerusalem, Jerusalem, how often would I have gathered you as a hen with her broods? But you would not."
I think both of them goes to the law of the love. Because to him, that's what, when they wouldn't come to him, to in his heart, that he lost. And that's what I mean. And I think about my mom, my dad, you know, my brother, we lost him. You know, we.
Because my heart really in what you're feeling inside.
For you that don't know, Brother Norman's son passed away. Yes. I know probably everybody knows it, but we didn't share it on Facebook there because of wasn't sure how he wanted us to on it, but you know, we knew that it was coming today, so just please keep Norman and Carrie lifted up in prayer on that today, because that causes the weep, don't it, brother? That hurt. And that's the thing. That hurt that's there. Think about the difference between weeping and laughing. When you're hurting, you will weep. When you're laughing, is there any hurt there? Because you can cry and laugh. I mean, Rhonda does it all the time. She does that too sometimes, Johnny. That little, I won't say it, she's going to get in trouble. But she laughs, and she goes to laughing so hard that she's crying. But you cannot weep and cry, because there's sorrow in weeping. There's rejoicing, there's joy in laughter. And I'm telling you, it's oil and water. They just won't mix together. I mean, they're like two magnets. They're going to push one another apart. They're going to they're not going to connect. It's impossible. So, if you're weeping now, weeping may endure for the night, but laughter or joy is coming in the morning, right? All right. Blessed are ye when men shall hate you. Think about that. Blessed are ye when men shall hate you. Really, I'm blessed because people hate me? We got to finish that, don't we, before we actually know why. And when they shall separate from you further from you from their company, and shall reproach you, and cast your name as evil for the Son of Man's sake. How many here has ever been wronged by somebody? Hold your hand up. I mean, remember the song? I've been lied on, cheated, talked about, mistreated. Have we not? Why? Because of the name of Christ. When you suffer that way for the name of Christ, I'm telling you, them people didn't love you anyhow. Right? Just be honest about it. And you'll not love God. If you love God and you do people that way, you're a liar. You cannot treat your fellow man this way and claim to love God. Now, I mean, to think about what? They hate you. They separate them. I mean, for no good reason. Except that you take a stand for the gospel. And reproach. What does it mean to reproach you? They're out speaking evil against you and bringing shame, and they're lying all these different things on you for the Son of Man's sake.
I think the one that we notice most is when we get saved,
those friends and those that used to come around and drink and party, they just don't go no more. They don't associate with you. They are not friendly like they used to be. Even family separates herself from you.
But I think this really goes to speaking to religious people that claim the name of God. I think that's what he's really speaking of here, because, I mean, think about it. Jesus said, you know, you're the son of the devil. You're full of the devil.
No, they were Jews.
They were, but that's what I'm saying. They were religious people. You got to realize everybody that carries a Bible and that sings the songs of Zion and speaks Christianese, amen, praise the Lord, all these different things, are not Christians. They will hurt you if they get the opportunity to make themselves look better. Amen. It's more about promoting themselves than it is about promoting God. We have to make sure that attention is not pointed toward us. It's toward God. When we take a stand to teach or to preach or to sing or to testify, we are representing our Savior, not... We need to close the next one up. The next blind up, is it bothering you now? Okay. She just kind of had her eye kept around her glasses. I just want to make sure. All right. But when all that happens, you are blessed. Why are you still blessed? Jesus loves me, this I know, for the Bible tells me so. Little ones to him belong.
We know Jesus loves us, but I'm going to tell you, when a brother wronged you,
it hurts. It causes you to weep. It causes you to weep, absolutely. All right, let's look at verse 27 and 28. But I say unto you which hear, love your enemies, do good to them which hate you. You know, when someone wrongs us, we've got a choice to make. Because if we harbor hard feelings against that individual, does it hurt them? I mean, how much sleep do they lose over it? If they're truly a child of God, they'll come back and they'll apologize. They'll lose some sleep over it, and they'll come back and they'll apologize. But if they just go on and, you know, they're not right. And for you to be happy, pray for them, love your enemies, and do good to them. We never render evil for evil, right? Bless them that hate you and pray for them which despitefully use you. I realize that's hard, but here's the thing. People that are continually walking in that thing, do men make mistakes? Absolutely. But again, they'll see the error of their way. They'll come back. If they're right, they'll apologize and make things right. But them that despitefully, just out of spite, that's what that word means, just out of spite when it says despitefully, just because they can hurt you, pray for them. Verse 32, for if you love them which love you, What thank have you? In other words, what good? But for sinners also love those that love them. Verse 36. For be ye therefore merciful as your Father also is merciful. And I think that hinges, the whole thing falls to that one verse right there. You can't get mercy. I mean, the scripture's plain. If you cannot forgive them, neither will their Father in heaven forgive you. I mean, it's plain. Judge not, that ye be not judged. Condemn not, and ye shall not be condemned. Forgive, and ye shall be forgiven. Now let's, people love to take this first part of this verse out, and they'll hang on it, and they leave everything else out of it. No, the Bible says for you, you don't have the right to judge me. We hear it all the time. You don't have the right to judge me. Judge not that ye be not judged. If a person is openly walking in sin, as a child of God, you have the right to go to them in love and compassion and say, listen, this is what the Scripture says about that. You've got to change. You've got to repent. And that's what repent means, by the way, is change. Quit doing it. If they won't hear you, you take two or three witnesses. If they won't hear the two or three witnesses, you're supposed to bring them before the whole church. And if they won't change, the whole church is supposed to say, adios, amigos. That's the correct way of handling someone that's doing wrong, is it not? But in today's society, we're not allowed to speak up, because if we speak up, you're judging. I'm not judging. When the Bible says it's wrong for you to lie, thou shalt not bear false witness. I've got a right, if you've bared false witness, to call you a bluff and say, you know, you're lying. Right? If you thou shalt not steal. Well, don't judge. Yeah, but you stole. Right? Regardless of what the sin may be, and you know, we categorize sin. Sin is sin. Whether from a lie to murder, sin is sin. We've got to comprehend that fact that we can. I mean, black is black and white is white.
We always have to be careful, though.
We've got to do it in love.
And white is white. But you know, I'm going to tell you, about 3 weeks ago, someone called me a liar. I made a mistake. I didn't lie. Did I willingly lie? No, I wouldn't. But it wasn't right. It wasn't the truth. Come to find out, it wasn't.
A lot of times,
watch what you're saying.
If you're going, you've got to.
I've got that in my face for the rest of my life. I'm going to see that. You liar.
We've got to make sure. You can't. You've got to know the whole story. True?
Mm-hmm.
I mean.
But with that, then not be able to say, okay. I didn't mean that.
How it should have been handled was, you know, let me tell you all of what's going on here. Evidently, you don't know the whole story. Instead of walking right up and tell somebody, you know, there's right way. You see, but it goes back to what I just said. You've got to do it in meekness and in love. And that's not in love when you're just outright in anger.
Amen.
Point the finger. We can't do that. We've got to do it in Christian love and fellowship, right?
Amen.
All right.
The Word of God is the one that does the judging.
That's right.
We can face them with the Word of God, and if that don't correct or condemn them.
For a good tree, verse 43, for a good tree bringeth not forth corrupt fruit, neither doth a corrupt tree bring forth good fruit. You'll never find a pear on an apple tree. Now, I realize today they are however they're doing, they have trees out that will bear several different kind of fruits. They've some kind of hybrid that they've mixed up. But I'm telling you what, if you take a pear off of one of those trees, or an apple off one of them trees, that bears all, I think they bear like either five or seven different kinds of fruit. And if you take that seed and you plant that seed in the ground, it'll come up an apple tree. There'll be no other thing on that tree but an apple. They take that branch and they graft that branch. There's the word I was looking for, graft. Graft that branch onto that stump. All that stump does is bring up the sap and the moisture and stuff out of the ground, the nutrients out of the ground to that branch. That branch is where that fruit comes on and it bears out. So if you are a corrupt branch, you're going to bring forth corrupt. I don't care what you're connected to. If you connect, a good tree cannot bring forth corrupt fruit. Neither can a corrupt tree bring forth good fruit. For every tree is known by his own fruit. All right, I realize that. Every tree is known by its fruit. Now, is there a such thing? Is there a license for you and I to be fruit inspectors? Huh?
Aren't we supposed to be?
Fruit inspectors? That's God's job. How is it my job to judge your fruit? I mean, I'm to look and say whether... Now, again, a good tree cannot bring forth corrupt fruit. Neither can a corrupt tree bring forth good fruit. So if it's good, what are you saying? Here's the thing. If what I'm doing points toward God and reflects God, it's good. If what I'm doing reflects self or anything else, it's corrupt. Everything that we're to do today is to, and that's why we're here, is to point people to God. That's why we're Christians. I mean, the word Christian means to be Christ-like. True? Is it not? That doesn't mean now we walk around with a long robe on and all. What it means is our will is not to please ourselves, but to please God who sent us. That's what a Christian is. That's why Christ came. He said, I came not to do my will, but the will of him that sent me. So if I'm going to reflect him, my number one job has got to be glorifying and pointing people to God. If they're pointing people to God, it's good fruit. If I get up and I sing a song and it blesses, let's say it blesses Susie, and Susie just rejoices and cries and all these different things, and I begin to take pride for it and say, no, and Susie, I just, you know, there's the whole thing. When men start out throwing that I word out there, there's trouble coming. Because you've got an I problem. Your eyes are off of the Lord and on yourself. Amen. For me to walk up to a tree and say, you know, that apple's no good, and that apple's no good, and that apple's no good, but all the rest of them's good, I can't do that. Because there's good fruit there. What are you saying? I'm saying we cannot nitpick one another apart. How do we know that we're brothers and sisters in Christ? How do we know? Come on. That we love one another. Now, if I'm mistreating you, guess what? I don't love you. I love me. We are to love our brother above ourselves. Do we fall short of that sometimes? Absolutely. But I'm not saying that we're brothers and sisters in Christ. We don't make mistakes that we don't fall. But if I continually treat you bad, I'm not your brother. That's just fact of the matter. If I'm always out for old number one, you know, if I walk in here and I just look at the board and say, you know, y'all just want to start paying me more money or I'm leaving. You know who I'm thinking about? Old number one. Brother Dave, one of the questions Dave asked me every year, said, how do you think about your salary? I said, the church can't afford to pay no more. You know why? I'm thinking about the church. I'm not thinking about myself. Brother Dave, am I right on that? And I'm not saying that to glorify myself. I know where we stand. We got to labor together. I appreciate all that you do. Again, I did not ask for a salary, but it helps, all right? But we've got to make sure our fruit bears witness. If we're bringing forth good fruit for the kingdom of God, not for ourselves. For every tree is known by its fruit, for of thorns men do not gather figs, nor of a bramble bush do they gather grapes. You know what a bramble bush is? Around here we call them tumbleweeds. It's a bush that just rolls from place to place, never takes any root downward, never bears any fruit. It never does anybody any good. I've seen people like that in churches, folks. They blow in. We had a guy, when I was over at Rutland, we had a guy come in there, and he wasn't there long, and you can ask Ron, this is fact. He said, you know, we're here. Amen, but this is what's wrong with your Sunday school. Amen, you got one great big huge class, and you're going to have to break it down in smaller groups, and going to have to do this and going to have to do that, or we ain't staying long. And then he went talk to one of the deacons, you know, and he said, you know, if they don't put me on the board and let me be a deacon, he said, I probably ain't going to be here long. I said, goodbye. I don't care how many deacon boards you've set. I'm going to tell you something about a fellow that goes to the church, and next thing you know, he's on every board his aunt can get on. Shame on the church. Let him labor and work together among them. The Bible says, know them that labor among you. So if we just throw them straight in there, shame on us.
I wouldn't like that.
Absolutely.
That's a scary thought that we turn our lives. Because our deacons are before us. They're standing up for us. They're I appreciate what they do. We have to hold them at that standard. It's like Johnny. He's held up for a deacon. And I think he's done a wonderful job. And you know, as I've got to know him, that's our job to get to know Johnny.
And that's why you set someone aside to prove whether or not they're going to fill that office. That's why you set them aside. So, again, you know them by the fruit. If they're bringing, you know, again, don't nitpick. If it's of God, the Spirit will bear witness, all right? If it's not of God, it'll come to naught. And I can tell you, and Rhonda will tell you, that within a year to year and a half, that fellow and his wife were going on to the next church. And I mean, they just went from, I'm telling you, I can name the churches that fellow had attended and we've been on the board on every one of them. Now, he later came back to that church after I left and ended up being on the board. He's dead and gone now. I'm not naming any names. Most of y'all wouldn't know who he is, but I'm telling you, I'm not judging that guy far as saying how his salvation is. I'm saying today that I had no confidence in him to be a leader. You can be a Christian, but everybody ain't leadership material. Because sometimes it gets the choices you got to do, the things you've got to do as a leader, it takes some guts.
Exactly. That's what I was trying to say.
All right. Let's take a break and we'll come back for our worship.